Childhood dystonia. This includes all the causes of dystonia that affect the child, whatever age, including teenagers with dystonia. Clearly, childhood dystonia includes the dystonic cerebral palsies, which are discussed in more detail in another section. But just to recap, cerebral palsy is considered to be a movement disorder which occurs in the first 2 years of life, and after those 2 years, the term cerebral palsy no longer applies. So effectively, we're dealing with dystonias that affect children from the age of 2 till the age of 18, which is a long time. The causes of dystonia are similar to the causes of brain injury in children. So accidents and trauma to the brain, infection of the brain, neuroinflammatory disorders, which are like infections but are caused usually by the immune system rather than by infections directly. Metabolic disorders, which represent a defect in a very, very large number of biochemical processes in the cells, and each of which require separate diagnostic techniques, and some of which, but by no means all, can be managed with very specific treatments using vitamins and replacement chemicals. Tumors and cancers cause dystonia. A relatively well understood mechanism of dystonia is a stroke in childhood. That can be caused by a deprivation of the bloodstream to important structures in the brain like the basal ganglia. And the commonest cause of this occurs within the first year after having had chickenpox. What's interesting is that after you've had chickenpox, at a much later age, you can have shingles, which is chickenpox coming out along a nerve in the body. And shingles tends to occur in adults who have got a lowering of immunity. And shingles is a major cause of stroke in adults. So the chickenpox virus, which causes chickenpox illness in children, can cause strokes in childhood. But later on, the same virus can cause strokes in adults after shingles. So this is a common infection that is a cause of stroke in childhood. There are toxic causes of dystonia. If you inhale certain chemicals, they can affect very sensitive structures in the brain like the basal ganglia. And it's very important to be aware of the possibility of a toxic agent coming from various industrial processes. Everybody's aware of heavy metal poisoning, and typically those were highlighted in the 1960s when there was mercury poisoning in Japan that caused a whole group of children to be affected with mercury poisoning. So the environment produces triggers that cause dystonic disorders and need to be managed appropriately. Putting all of these different conditions, of which some of them are very common, such as accidents, trauma, drowning, a cause of interruption of breathing. There are a lot of common mechanisms for childhood onset dystonias that must be added to the more predictable causes of childhood onset dystonia through the cerebral palsy pathway. So there must be probably another 10 or 20,000 people with childhood onset dystonias that have occurred through one of these mechanisms, which have not yet, we don't have reliable figures for. Certainly tens of thousands are attributable to these additional causes. And then you have the genetic dystonias, which I've left to the last, because they are rarer but becoming commoner because we are expanding our understanding of genes that can cause dystonia. It used to be considered that the DYT1 torsion A mutation was the commonest genetic dystonia, but this is now being challenged by another group of dystonias which occur much earlier on, such as the KMT2B mutation or the GNAO1 mutation. And this seems to affect a wider group of children at an earlier age. We're coming to a point where GNAO1 dystonias and KMT2B dystonias are certainly visible around about the age of 2, which is the outer limit of time for cerebral palsy. And it's often the case that if you look carefully at children, you'll notice signs earlier than the currently recognized age of onset of KMT2B. And therefore, the question arises that if you have a genetic dystonia that occurs under the age of 2, do they have cerebral palsy due to a known genetic abnormality? And in the broad sense, the answer is yes. If we look at the cerebral palsy profile in more detail, 15 to 20% of these cases have apparently normal brain scans. And that would mean that there is a chance that those children who don't have any alternative explanation for their movement disorder have got an underlying genetic disorder that needs to be searched for. Once you've excluded the fact that they were premature or had some other difficulty during the pregnancy or at delivery or in the immediate period after delivery. So we're going to have a situation where increasingly we are screening children with early onset dystonias for genetic disorders. And it's very clear that the number of disorders with a genetic origin causing dystonia in childhood will rise. And this will also influence how we go about managing those dystonias, because whichever way you look at the problem, the earlier and the more successful the management, the better the outlook for the child's development, for their activity and their participation. And age-appropriate lifestyles. So in some ways, part of the cerebral palsy versus genetic dystonia debate will fuse, because a whole group of children who have cerebral palsy will also have genetic disorders. And therefore the medical and scientific community will have to come together and consider that early intervention strategies are essential for these children.